This is Josh and a Lady.
Misinformation, disinformation, malinformation, propaganda, whatever you want to call it, we're going to call out deception online in Canada. We'll talk about how it's spread, bots, troll farms, trolls, who's behind it, dark money, oil, and we will talk about some of the major players in this campaign of disinformation, spreading dangerous misinformation funded by dark money. Outlets such as True North, Rebel Media, Post Millennial, The Sun and the National Post, The National Telegraph, Kian Bexley of The Countersignal, Andrew Lawton, Candace Malcolm, Blacklocks, Sheila Gunn, The Western Standard, Ezra Levent, all those people and companies come up in this talk about misinformation. We spoke to a woman by the name of Heather, who we're not going to use her last name because in the past she's been doxxed and swarmed by online haters because of the truth she tells. You can find her on Twitter at Heather Mo and Co. At Heather Mo and Co. And this is how the conversation went. So Heather, can you tell us what your focus is on?
I would call myself an independent researcher focusing on malign influence operations and their use of social media. I have a particular focus on Twitter, but I do look at other platforms as well, but mostly Twitter.
So let's talk about some of the terms that you use when talking about these sites and these influencers.
Yeah, so there's a few terms that people confuse a lot. So like the term bots, for example, people misuse that term a lot. So bots they're automated accounts. It's just software. So they're not inherently good or bad. It's how they're used. It determines whether they're good or bad. So bots can be used to generate messages about an upcoming natural disaster, in which case they're good. They can be benign and when, software generating content about a product like selling yogurt or something, or they can be malicious. And that's kind of where we want to concentrate our attention on is the malicious use of automated accounts and what they do. So their tweets and content, like the frequency of the tweets and the content, are controlled by software. The other term that people throw around a lot is trolls. Mm-hmm. Trolls are fake, they're fake accounts, they're false identities. They can either be assumed by individuals acting by themselves, just, kind of very angry, screwed up people who are very malicious online, or they can be part of an organized group. So like a troll factory, for example, where they are paid deception agents online. And so they handle multiple accounts at once. And their purpose is really disruption and to spread disinformation and attack. Cyborgs are a kind of a combination of the previous two. So cyborg accounts are partially automated accounts combined with human handlers. So a troll factory, for example, can manage many, many, many more accounts when they're partially automated. So you have bots that will continue spreading information and a narrative when the human handler is offline, and the human handler can now handle 100 accounts or maybe even more, because bots handle part of the operation while the human handler does part of the job as well. So those are the three kind of inauthentic actors online: bots, trolls, and cyborgs. There's also sock puppet accounts, and those are anonymous accounts with a default profile image, and they're usually used to kind of bypass removal by social media companies like Twitter. Sock puppets will often come like to praise the account that the someone else is at their other account. So let's say you've got somebody who has a couple of sock puppets, and they come on to just kind of boost themselves and their other accounts online, pretending they're a third party separate individual.
I was just going to say, and you even break it down further when it comes to propaganda, disinformation, misinformation, malinformation. Maybe we can kind of outline those terms as well.
Okay, so misinformation is false information that's accidentally spread, where the person spreading the false information is unaware of the falsehood. They think they're spreading accurate information when they're not. Disinformation is the false information that is like deliberately spread in with the intent to deceive. Malinformation is it's factual information, but it's spread with the malicious context. So it's meant to mislead or inflict harm. So like hacked emails, revenge porn, doxing, things acquired by phishing, those are all examples of malinformation. Propaganda can be true or false. So it can contain elements of disinformation, malinformation, but its ultimate purpose is to influence and manipulate. There are some researchers, like a friend of mine who's Mark Owen Jones, he prefers the term deception. And the reason he prefers the term deception is because it carries with it the mode of delivery as well as the content itself. So like deception is more about the means of delivery. So like if somebody, even if they're spreading something that has elements of truth, if they're using like 1,000 fake accounts to spread it, it's a safe bet that their intentions are not good. So they're deliberately trying to obfuscate what their intentions really are. So I prefer the term propaganda or deception, because both of the terms kind of can encompass all of the like malinformation, disinformation, misinformation, where the intention is to manipulate and to really cause an emotional response to kind of bypass people's critical thinking. They want people to react emotionally and not really think about the content.
You did mention bots. You also mentioned trolls, and people often talk about Russian troll farms. What exactly is a troll farm?
So a troll farm is, or a troll factory, also called a troll factory. And so it's where there are large numbers of inauthentic accounts handled by people hired to pose as authentic users for malign purposes. So these are very often state-backed operations. So like the most famous is the Russian Internet Research Agency, which was on the vanguard of this malicious activity. So they're kind of like pioneers of malicious online activity. And the Internet Research Agency did all kinds of things. They would pose as journalists publishing articles in different publications. They would have a fake profile picture. So they'd have it's called a GAN image, a generated adversarial network image. So it looks like a real person, but the person doesn't exist. It's an AI generated photo. So they would use an AI generated photo. They'd create content. They'd create a LinkedIn profile. They'd create a Facebook page. They'd pose as a real person when they were not. They were working at the Internet Research Agency, and they were pumping out disinformation. So these accounts, like, they would pose as black activists in the United States with the purpose of trying to dissuade people from voting for Hillary Clinton, for example. And this was prior to the 2016 US election. They would also pose as Trump supporters in order to mobilize Trump supporters to get people to vote for Trump. So on the one hand, they wanted to mobilize voters towards Trump, and they wanted to dissuade the left, people on the left, from voting for Hillary. So there was a massive propaganda campaign. They would pose as a lot of black activists. They even had Facebook groups called Blacktivists. They were quite organized, and they had thousands of followers and thousands of members, all believing that they were legitimate black activists, when in fact they were trolls at the troll factory in St. Petersburg. But like, so just another thing about that. So now, so like that's kind of, that was sort of like where it started, but now there are troll factories all over the world. There are India, Moldova, Gambia, the Philippines, even Arizona. And PR companies are often used as brokers for troll farms for hire. So you have these troll factories that are just for hire. So you can buy the operations of a troll factory out of the Philippines, out of, you know, India. You can just pay for their services, and they can engage in these kind of malign activities. And a PR company is the broker, so it disguises who the real client is. So there's a lot of fake stuff online.
Yeah, it's insane. I was talking with you a bit earlier and mentioned that I just was interested in some of these right-wing tweets, and I would sometimes reply to them because it makes me angry seeing disinformation or misinformation. And now Twitter is feeding me, without my having to follow them, feeding me all kinds of right-wing nonsense. I'm seeing Theo Fleury, Jamie Soleil, all these, and all kinds of misinformation spreaders. But I didn't ask for it. It's just coming my way.
Yeah, and so that's a really important aspect of this, actually, because you don't. So let's take an example. This is based on the research of my hero, Dr. Kathleen Carley at Carnegie Mellon University, and so they looked at, I forget the exact number of accounts, but I believe it was in the millions of accounts, and they were looking at accounts. A really great example of this, it was the Reopen America campaign that Carnegie Mellon University team looked at. And so it began, so there were like very large numbers of accounts that were created right at the beginning of the pandemic. Even like, I believe, like before any kind of lockdown or anything like that, it was like February of 2020, which is quite interesting. There were all of these accounts, and so they were tweeting, they were bots. So these weren't even trolls or anything like that. This was automated, software-driven COVID disinformation. And this was right at the beginning. And they were driving anywhere from 45 to 60% of all tweets about COVID were coming from bots. Then they started to kind of bridge together, these bots started to bridge together different groups. So they started to tweet about, like, you know, anti-lockdown. But they were also, interestingly enough, they were tweeting pro-lockdown, but their purpose was very different. So about 75% of the accounts were tweeting anti-lockdown propaganda and about 25% pro-lockdown, but the anti-lockdown was about bridging people together and creating a cohesive message against lockdowns, while its purpose, the bots, what they were doing with anti-lockdown, was trying to like disorganize the messaging. They were trying to diffuse the messaging and confuse and create mixed messages and some chaos. So their purpose was very different on both sides of the debate. Then they started to bridge together anti-mask groups with anti-lockdown groups. Then as the vaccines became available, they would bridge together anti-vaccine, anti-lockdown, anti-mask. And then they would start to bridge them with other groups like pro-gun groups. And their purpose of bridging these groups together, these groups were kind of, they didn't really talk to each other. They weren't really together in terms of their communication, but the bots were driving these groups together via Twitter. They were exploiting Twitter's algorithms. So it didn't matter if you were following these accounts, just as you are seeing all of these right-wing propaganda accounts and so on. Those are kind of algorithm driven. And so these bots were exploiting the algorithms to recommend these groups together, show them content to each other, whether they followed them or not. And then they would all start to kind of coalesce, and they'd start to communicate, they'd start to follow each other. Then they'd start to form this very large network of anti-mask, anti-vax, anti-lockdown. They'd have wellness people who were anti-vaccine, and they would bring those into the groups. They'd have the gun rights. Then once they had all of these groups kind of bridged together, they were feeding them propaganda and disinformation. So they would start to feed in conspiracy theories like, you know, CDC disinformation, World Health Organization disinformation, targeting Dr. Fauci, demonizing him. Then there was like the 5G conspiracy theories. So they were flooding all of these networks with these conspiracy theories. Then everything started to take a rhetorical shift. Then the bots started to kind of steer these groups towards the belief about rights, that anti-vaccine was really about your right to not have the vaccine, your right to not wear a mask. So then these groups started to believe that it's a violation of their individual rights to be asked to have a vaccine or wear a mask, or any of those sort of public health measures became a violation of their personal rights. So then you started to kind of radicalize people in a sense, because they started to have this emotional response to just public health measures that were designed to try to stem this pandemic that was killing people. So, and causing not, and even, you know, not arguably just as bad, are the effects of long COVID. So there's cardiovascular disease, there's neurological problems, there's all kinds of like very significant mental health problems, not about the lockdowns, but about how like there's a psychiatric illness goes up 50% if you've had COVID. So there's all kinds of very serious health outcomes from COVID. And so public health measures meant to protect people were now just being seen as political when they're not. They're not political, but they became political and they became about people's rights. And when they did, you now have a large group that becomes an echo chamber. You can feed conspiracy theories and disinformation. And now this network, this echo chamber, then kind of all feeds into each other. And then you have combined with that, which we're going to talk about later, but we can get into it now. Now you have all of these propaganda deception publications spreading conspiracies and propaganda and disinformation, and those are the publications that are getting fed into these networks that are now echo chambers, bot driven, in a lot of inauthentic activity, but made up of large numbers of real people. And those real people, they know they're not a bot. So if you sort of say like, oh, you're spreading disinformation, you're a bot, they know they're not. So then they discount any information coming in because they're like, you know, they can, well, you're just wrong. You're just wrong because I know I'm not a bot. And all of these people that I follow on Twitter, I know they're not bots too, even though they really don't know that. They don't know if they're a troll or a bot, but right, they do know that they're not. So then you sort of have this belief system becoming entrenched. So now they believe these things are about their rights. They believe these things about conspiracy theories and 5G networks and RF, the tags that they're put in, that they believe was put in the vaccine to control them, and all kinds of crazy stuff, and QAnon and all of these kinds of conspiracies can now start to shape people's behaviors, and they believe it's completely organic, and it's not. It is very inauthentic in terms of what is driving it and in terms of how the disinformation is fed into it, and yet they feel like they're doing their own research and that all of this is organic. And they also have the sense that it's a giant movement when really it's not that big, but they have a sense that it's a giant movement. So anything contra to those beliefs, they now think that is fake, because, well, I believe this and all my friends believe it and all of these quote unquote fake news, or I mean real actual fake news publications, these disinformation publications, they all say this is true. So they start to solidify in their belief system. And it's very challenging. Once they have that framework in place, they'd sooner reject the incoming information that that contradicts that framework rather than alter the framework. So it's a hacking of the human brain that's going on, and it's very complex and it's very serious and it's growing more complex all the time.
Well, especially with a new technology, it's becoming easier and easier for them to propagate.
Yeah, and as these networks solidify and grow, they become more believable to the people who are in those echo chambers. Because if you have, you know, it's easy to discount maybe something that comes from one of these publications, but if you have 15 or 20 of these publications all saying the same thing, in addition to bot-driven amplification of all of these different accounts who are also saying the same thing, people believe, well, that surely this must be true then. I've often had conversations where I'm quite certain it's a real person. if it's a troll or a bot, and this is advice I will give to everyone. If somebody is just coming on to it, coming up in your mentions or replying to a post of yours, just to say, you know, like to shit post or to like, you know, be disruptive or just say deflect or say something ridiculous, do not engage with those accounts at all, because they're meant to give you an emotional response, and they're meant to make you angry so that you'll reply to them, and then that will amplify their status, if you will, in terms of the algorithms. It will make them more visible to other people. So do not engage with them. Don't reply to them. Immediately
them.
Block them. Nice. You can even report and block them, but I don't know that reporting does all that much, but you can give it a try. Report and block. Take a screenshot of what they're saying, and then post their screenshot and reply to the screenshot.
To the screenshot, right.
So that's what I do. So trolls come at me all, trolls and bots come at me all the time. So I just take a screenshot and then I post a whole bunch of the screenshots of things that they've said. And then I debunk what they've said in the screenshot. So I've now blocked them. They can't reply to me. And they're fake accounts anyway. So it doesn't, you know, doesn't matter. You definitely don't want to engage with them.
No.
If it's a real person who's coming from that world, I do engage with them and I do try to talk to them and get a sense of like, okay, why do you believe this? And they'll be outraged at facts, you know, that are provable facts. And then sometimes if you have a like respectful enough dialogue, they will start to kind of go, okay, like I'll at least think about this. But there's a tendency that all of us have, like when we're riled up and we just say like, well, you're an idiot and, you know, you don't know anything, and how can you be so ignorant? So that's what our emotional response tends to be. But if we can, if you know it's a real person, and you can have a respectful dialogue with them, I think that's always a good thing. If you can try to come to some understanding with them. But when it's just trolls and fake accounts and everything else, just block them and don't engage at all, because it really just helps drive their disinformation. It doesn't do anything, and it just riles us up too. We just get more angry. It doesn't really accomplish anything worthwhile.
No, we're talking to Heather, and we're not giving Heather's last name because, as often happens when people expose the truth, they're inundated by all kinds of garbage, docs, that type of thing. We can give your Twitter handle so people can follow you and see what it's all about. It's Heather Moe and Co. On Twitter.
At Heather Moe and Co.
Yes, at Heather Moe and Co. Yeah. We're going to come back in just a sec and talk briefly about why this is happening. What's the reason this messaging is being spread? Who's behind it? Hang around and we'll talk about that in just a sec. So we've talked about how it works to a large degree. Can we briefly talk about why it happens? Like, there's got to be a reason, or there's got to be some money behind this.
There's lots of money behind it, and so just as all of these networks are complex, so too are the players behind it. So it's not one, like there are adversarial actors behind it. Like, so ever since 2015, Canada's been the target of state-backed adversarial actors like China, Russia, definitely Russia, Iran, Saudi Arabia. I don't include America in that. There's lots of influence from the United States, but in terms of adversaries, Canada has been attacked since 2015. So there are many players going on here, and there's allegiances with many of these players as well. So you've got billionaires from the fossil fuel industry. You've got Republican operations. You've got, generally speaking, though, it's far right. It's the far right and the money behind them who is the beneficiary of the majority of these things. So there are definitely left-wing fakes as well. In fact, Russia does lots and lots of left-wing fakes and amplifies a lot of left-wing actors, but that's for the purposes of benefiting right-wing actors ultimately. So you have, you know, a lot of really billionaires whose interests are protected in or advanced, let's say, by these types of operations. You've got fossil fuel billionaires, you've got developers, you've got all kinds of, you know, tech, Peter Thiel, for example, and Elon Musk. Like they definitely, you know, fund a lot of questionable activities online. Peter Thiel started Rumble, which is a, you know, meant to challenge YouTube, but it's a disinformation. It's an incredibly toxic propaganda disinformation platform to post right-wing propaganda videos. Interestingly enough, Ezra Levant owns a slice of Rumble. So
not a
Ezra
huge
Levant
surprise.
Has questionable funding for yes. The Rebel, for example. There's a billionaire in California who is allegedly one of the funders of Rebel. Rebel has a lot of dark money. A lot of these are dark money publications. So they have their money. They claim that their money is coming from viewers and just small donations from the public. And this is really a disingenuous claim. Like their money is coming from a network of organizations in order to disguise who is really funding them. And a case in point would be True North Center, which is a charity.
Let me cut you off there
and
for a second.
So the reason it's a charity is because True North Center essentially took over in 2018 a charity that had been on the books since 1994. It was called the Independent Immigration Aid Association, and it was established in 1994 to help welcome immigrants from Britain to BC. So they found this very obscure little charity that had virtually no revenue, and so they took it over in order to get the charitable status. And then they began doing their propaganda, basically. And they're not supposed to be a political organization, and yet that's entirely what they are. But CRA, as far as I know, it's possible that they're auditing them now, but so far it appears that they still have their charitable status, right, and it hasn't been removed.
Heather, I'm gonna take a quick break because I have to get one more break in. But we mentioned Rebel News and we mentioned True North and Ezra Levant and Andrew Lawton as one of the main players. Let's come back and we'll go through a list of the main Canadian players in spreading this type of nonsense. Okay, we're talking to, we're not gonna say her last name. It's Heather. You can find her on Twitter at Heather Moen Co. And we'll come back and we'll name names in just a sec. Who are the people, the malign influencers here in Canada spreading misinformation? Let's try and make a list.
Let's not say misinformation because that's a misleading term. So they're spreading propaganda.
Yep.
They're spreading propaganda. Their purpose is political, and it's designed to misinform the public and to get the public. It's to manipulate the public for political reasons. So it's not meant to inform the public. It's not journalism. It is meant to sway people politically.
Okay. Let's start. We talked about True North, and the face of True North seems to be Andrew Lawton. What can you tell us about him?
And Candace Malcolm.
Okay. Both of those people.
Yeah. So Andrew Lawton started at The Rebel. There's a lot of rebel connections in a lot of these. Like, it's a launch pad for a lot of, you know, malicious content online and propaganda. So Andrew Lawton started there. He's friends with Kian Bexty, who also began at The Rebel, who is now with his own disinformation publication called Counter Signal, and it's really as bad and malicious and toxic as The Rebel is. Counter Signal is even more so. Can be worse than The Rebel, Counter Signal is it. He is really and with every op, with every influence operation, propaganda operation, destabilization operation, he's in there. He was at the January 6th insurrection, supporting it, pumping out propaganda about it. He was part of the United We Roll propaganda operation, which was the test run precursor to the Ku Klux Klan, the quote-unquote freedom convoy. So he was part of that initial precursor operation. And so all the things they learned in 2019 at United We Roll, and it's many of the same players, Tamara Leach, like all of those, all or Litch, however you pronounce her name, a lot of these people, Pierre Poilievre, all of these people were part of that operation, and then they launched the more advanced operation, which was the quote-unquote freedom convoy. So Bexty is right in the heart of all of these malign influence operations, destabilization operations, propaganda operations. He's right in there pumping out very disruptive, malicious content. Mm. And he's friends with Andrew Lawton.
Andrew Lawton's quite a character too, quite a history of saying...
saying all kinds of misogynistic, things. Islamophobic, like on Canada Day, was it last, I believe it was last year, on Canada Day 2021, it was after all of the graves were found of the residential school children. And so a lot of people agreed on Canada Day 2021 to use it as a day of reflection about past wrongs that Canada had done to our Indigenous populations. And so on that day, Andrew Lawton chose to tweet out "Happy Dominion Day, keep our land glorious and free," and he posted a picture of the red ensign. And so the red ensign has been adopted by far-right groups, neo-Nazi groups, fascist groups. They've adopted it as a symbol of white supremacy and white nationalism. So it's really taken on a dark, you know, the Aryan Guard uses it. They featured the red ensign. It was like a perverse thing to tweet on Canada Day when people are, you know, many, many people across the country were deciding to use it as a day of reflection. He has a history with far-right gun groups, misogyny, white nationalism, white supremacy. So all of these people, like, you could say the through line, there's a lot of white nationalism, white supremacy through line with a lot of these groups as well, for sure. So, including Andrew Lawton and Kian Bexty.
So let's talk some of the other ones I have here on the list, the post-millennial.
Yeah, and so the post-millennial is one of those cross-border propaganda, disinformation, malinformation publications that was one of the founders is Matthew Azrieli from the Azrieli multi-billionaire developer tycoon family. And they're also connected with Jeff Ballingall, who is their chief marketing officer, or at least he was. And he was a co-owner, according to the National Post, but I haven't found evidence of that, other than the National Post saying it. It does a lot of double duty of amplifying American and Canadian disinformation and ping-ponging them back and forth. So they do things like they helped tank Peter McKay's campaign. That, like, you know, I don't know if Peter McKay knew that Jeff Ballingall was working for Aaron O'Toole when Ballingall was using the post-millennial to go after McKay, but that's the kind of thing that they do. They kind of work in tandem to go after targets, and so they'll have propaganda. The post-millennial will amplify a lot of Tucker Carlson. Tucker Carlson will amplify a lot of anti-Trudeau disinformation and propaganda. And they'll kind of use each other. So there's a lot of American players who will amplify post-millennial and back and forth. And all of these people are so very much connected, like Jeff Ballingall, who is connected to Canada Proud, or is the founder of Canada Proud, is connected to post-millennial and so on. So there's a lot of amplification of, you know, malicious content. And manipulative content meant to, you know, cause an emotional response and sure. sway people politically.
Let's talk about a couple of more of these names that keep coming up. What about Blacklock's?
Well, Blacklock's reporter, Holly Doan, who Blacklock's began as is an interesting case because it began as a, you know, quote unquote, legitimate publication, and it's become more and more and more propaganda over time, and it's become it amplifies a lot of interesting hit jobs, for example. So they're kind of more of an example of what I would call malinformation and propaganda. So they'll take things that are fragments of truthful factual information, but they'll contextualize it in a way that is meant to manipulate. So they have a political agenda as opposed to a journalistic agenda. And they didn't start off that way. They just started off as a publication that was holding truth to power. And now they've become very, very much an amplifier of political hit jobs. So Holly Doan, you know, reports to be a journalist, but her agenda is political, not journalism. She would probably argue that fact, sure. But that's my opinion of what she does.
Okay,
what that publication does.
What about the National Telegraph?
I would call it just a rag. Like, I would call it a disinformation publication. The National Telegraph, for example, was saying things like there were 50,000 trucks as part of the quote-unquote trucker convoy. There were, at maximum, according to Ottawa police, 400. So not even in the ballpark of 50,000. But it kept repeating this 50,000 number, and it kept pumping out disinformation. It's related to Tom Quiggin, but interestingly enough, you don't see Tom Quiggin's name anywhere on the National Telegraph anymore, which is very curious. But you do see them promoting him a lot and retweeting him a lot, and you'd see him retweeting them a lot. And so, an interesting thing that I discovered recently was that they were buying pro Pierre Poilievre ads, targeted ads on Facebook. But what's very interesting was it was like this student who writes for them was the purchaser of the ads. So this kid who is their quote unquote senior journalist. He's a student. Their senior journalist was buying multiple ads, targeted Facebook ads promoting Pierre Poilievre. Now, since when does a student a senior, your senior correspondent? And when does a student who writes for a publication buy advertising promoting a wealthy politician? So much of that picture is
wrong.
Very wrong and disturbing and very concerning. So a lot of these publications, True North Center, bought ads promoting, targeted ads promoting Pierre Poilievre. And a lot of this is the Cambridge Analytica model of targeted advertising in order to sway. Like if you're in a close election in a riding, if you can just sway, you can just shave off 3%, 4%, you can win that riding. So if you target, this was the strategy to elect Trump. So if you can target key in our case ridings, if you can target key ridings and shave off a few percentage points, you can sway that riding, you can win that riding, and you can then win an election. Even though, well, we saw with Doug Ford, what was it? 18% of the voting population voted for Doug Ford, yeah. And he has the biggest majority, a bigger majority this time than he did last time, based on 18% of people voting. Ugh. I mean, it's really quite appalling and terrifying. So anyone who thinks Poilievre can't win is mistaken.
Yes.
And they better get out and vote, and they better, you know, like, make sure they bring friends and get their friends to vote too, because they are very much doing a massive ground game, targeted ads, social media manipulation, propaganda, disinformation, all of it. They're using all of it, and there's a lot of money pushing him.
Yeah, we're almost out of time here. I could talk to you for another hour or so. This is so fascinating and so interesting. I will have to have you back, because we didn't even get a chance to cover The Sun and the National Post and their shift. But I will definitely have you back, and we'll talk about those things. If people want to see what you're up to, they can do so on Twitter. It's at Heather Moe and Co. And I highly suggest you check it out and see what's happening behind the scenes in this information war.
It is. It is. And it's an information war that we're in.
Thank you so much for coming on.
Hi. I just listened to your show with some, anyway, right or left wing quack. You know, you guys kill me. You could spew as much of your bullshit. And you know what? It's only your opinions. Let's get the facts. Let's get debating. Otherwise, it's all bullshit. So you guys have nothing to stand on. Keep spewing your misinformation, disinformation, a-hole. Okay? And yes, I'm a right wing. No, I'm not. I'm more of a humanitarian than you will ever be in your little toenail. Goodbye.